Hello, everybody, and welcome to another issue of Cross Border Talks. We are going to explore the political map of Bulgaria, having a closer look at possible external influences in the country and how the divisions on political scene reflect divisions in much bigger and stronger allies of Bulgaria. And we are also going to search for legacy of the huge mass protests that happened in Bulgaria not so long ago, but our guest Vladimir is going to argue left absolutely nothing behind. Well, why it happens so, and why this country in a beautiful part of the world cannot find a way to prosperity? These are the questions that we are going to try to answer in this issue of cross-border talks. And Vladimir, so perhaps we start with the legacy of the protests. Let me just remind that the protests in Bulgaria were perhaps not that popular in the mass media as the protests in Belarus running more or less in parallel time, but nevertheless were a huge, huge surprise in Bulgaria, a country which seemed to be completely, deprived of any hopes for a better future. And yet, in 2020, Bulgaria had hundreds, thousands of people in the streets, and not only in the capital city, in your city of Ruse as well. So, what did the protest leave behind?
Hello to everyone. It's a huge issue on one hand because this protest really grabs the attention of not only Bulgarians but also the world in a way, even though the Belarusian protests were going at the same time. We need to remind that there was a re resolution of the European Parliament in October 2020, which probably for the first time recognized openly that there is a problem with rule of law in Bulgaria. And also following the change of power in Bulgaria, the fall of Borisov government and the coming in power of a temporary interim government appointed by the President Rumen Radev, the USA have imposed sanctions upon two important oligarchs in Bulgaria, who were somehow believed to be close or used to have been close to the previous regime, what we have under Borisov. So there were developments on one hand. But on the other hand, I have written even that at Open Democracy and possibly in other media it can be read as well, that these protests didn't quite produce an agenda for change. They didn't have clear vision, in my view, beyond some general statements about anti-corruption fight. I guess a lot of people have been asking why, if the prosecutor general Ivan Geshev attacks certain large-scale businessmen, why the anti-corruption protests are against this chief prosecutor. So there are various things that need to be explained, but basically, at least if I have to be just in short now, I guess Bulgaria is not an exception to a number of countries of the region where certain oligarchies formed after the transition from socialism. And we also, when we look at the developments, we need to see that and understand that there is fight not only between international powers, such as, for example, Biden versus Trump or Bidenists versus Trumpists, but also between our local oligarchs who sometimes side with one party or with one leader and sometimes with another. I guess the interest of those people who rule Bulgaria, or the political elite, if I may say, or the economic elite, I guess their interest is maybe to reflect the changes in the world, to be prepared for what is happening around the world, and Bulgaria to have certain setups so that it could sail in those waters that are changing after the fall of Trump. But on the other hand, their interest is also not to this agenda of change not to be encouraged too much, and people are very well, I guess, for the Allies, if people play, if they are just somehow unaware of important processes or tendencies, and just attack one or the other structure when necessary. I don't know if I'm not too general, but maybe we could expand any of those issues further into the discussion.
It tempts me to ask, who are the people who rule Bulgaria? Because you used this expression, and a little bit earlier you said that one of the important developments after the protest was the fall of Borisov government, who honestly seemed to last forever in Bulgaria. And now with an interim government, with a series of elections that did not give a decisive result, and yet with a series of so-called anti-systemic parties that appear or reappear in Bulgarian political scene. So who are those who actually have to have the upper hand?
It's a large claim to make. If you expect me to name those people, I guess probably, as in most countries, they are not so much on the news. But one way to understand is to look at media and to look at political fights that have been going on in the last 10 or more years. And we, for example, may notice that a large number of political talk or developments have been circled around the contradiction between Pevsky and Prokopiev, who are two large-scale businessmen and who are said to have influence in various powers, including judicial or media power. So, but of course, they're not the only ones who are on the scene. And I guess we have reached, if I may expand the issue here, but if we look at media, basically, it looks like you have to be either a party or an oligarch in order to own a media. So if some media wants to have stability, financial stability, and to have certain consistencies in view, maybe, I don't know, it has to have an important power, political or economic power aligned to it. And certainly if we look at televisions or newspapers or whatever, we'll notice that basically a lot of businessmen, or some people use the term oligarchs, it looks like they fight their games or power fights through media and in politics. And of course, it has to be said that Bulgaria is not an island in the world, and there are also international interests. Especially Bulgaria is known for having a heterogeneous society. We are not so uniform as maybe some other societies appear to be. If you put some strategic foreign policy question, such as Macedonian questions or Russia or whatever, or even UK, EU, the attitudes are different. You don't have uniform attitude towards them. There are always conflicting opinions. Maybe that is the charm of Bulgaria, if you wish, if you can somehow live safely in that environment. Maybe you can learn a lot about the world. But once again, I reach the issue that, in my view at least, our allies are not so interested in speaking really to the core, getting to the core of certain issues, political, economic, etc. So we are more, maybe they are more interested in us dominating one another in society, but not somehow forming a common understanding or certain union or development together. That's about those people who rule Bulgaria.
So I am wondering, what are their ambitions in external politics, as this podcast is devoted mainly to international affairs? What are the plans for key allies of Bulgaria for Bulgaria? And how do the Bulgarian allies look at these plans? Bulgaria is, after all, a member of a few important international organizations, and it is also strategically located at the Black Sea. So it is impossible just to sleep calmly to discuss different matters. So even though your political elites are heterogeneous, there must be some final idea emerging from that.
It is once again an enigma in my view. What Bulgaria wants, it's an enigma, but of course there are some hints at what could be taking place, and let me just remind our reader that we are discussing in the context of forthcoming third elections in 1 year, third parliamentary elections, and together with them, presidential elections in November. And the Bulgarian parliament has just been disbanded for a second time in this year. So we also have the appearance on the horizon of a new, as they say, project, political project. Not, they don't use the term party. In fact, it's a political project formed by two popular ministers from the government, which was appointed by Rumen Radev as some kind of temporary government that should rule until parliament manages to form a government with its majority. But this didn't happen. So eventually this interim government with some changes continues. And well, in this context, what are the hints? I guess one hint is easy to be spotted, especially if you look at media in Bulgaria. So the internal probably is related to the legacy of Borisov, and there is certain attempt the President Radev is affirming his power, and possibly we need to see whether those forces who are aligned with Borisov are now in opposition, whether they will lose gradually their influence or they will manage to somehow preserve it. But also we have the international context where we know that Biden came in power in the USA in the beginning of this year. And also the USA, even though Biden was elected with many votes, however, many votes also were given to Donald Trump. And I guess this division is can be seen all over our region between, if I simplify them, Bidenists and Trumpists. So around this axis, people who are somehow more open to the current American administration, and people who are more open to the previous one, you can see in media certain clashes. And of course, everyone is right, and of course, the other one is always wrong. Maybe there are also other contradictions or hints which go a little bit unreported. For example, I remember seeing a few months ago a statement by the Prime Minister of Bulgaria, the temporary one, which used the term strategic autonomy when addressing certain, I think, group of businessmen. So one guess is that those tendencies which are characteristic for the EU and which involve certain clash between those classical Euro-Atlanticist countries or lobbies and those who are a little bit more open to open strategic autonomy. This maybe happens also in Bulgaria. However, it is not quite articulated. You may hear some foreign policy experts to speak in general about strategic autonomy or when to speak about it addressing the EU. That is also one thing I think I can say about Bulgaria. On one hand, things are not quite articulated in Bulgaria. You know, you don't get those concepts or stories that explain really what is going on. But on the other hand, I have the feeling Bulgarians, or at least the those people who are involved in politics, economy, they know well what is going on. I mean, they know who are they and they know who are their opponents. So that is one specific of Bulgaria. On one hand, nothing is told, everything is secret, and on the other hand, everything is known.
Sadly, one thing that is quite widely known about Bulgaria is also the fact that it is an extremely poor country, and that the economical transformation of the beginning, on one hand, gave the allowed the oligarchs to rise, you mentioned already, but on the other hand, also threw millions of Bulgarians into very bad economical conditions, particularly outside of the cities. And sadly, this does not change with protests, with all these discussions that take place more and more in the hiding and political scene. Bulgaria is still near the very end of the list of the most prosperous countries of Europe. It is on the beginning of the list of the countries with hugest inequalities. And I remember also our own talks in Rusa, in Bulgaria, when we discussed the general atmosphere of the country, the inequalities and the lack of chances for people who do not belong to any of those influential groups, who do not have contacts, etc. And I guess that the pandemics only worsened the situation.
There is always hope, and there must be hope that time is not does not stand still, and in a way that is why I'm also looking positively at what has been attempted or trying to happen in Bulgaria in the last year. That is why I also try to reflect on the protests which were 1 year ago. There is time, and also we still don't have quite clear articulation of the legacy of Borisov. I mean, when he ruled, we were aware of corruption. A lot of things were saying about mafia, etc. But still, I guess until the position of chief prosecutor is not changed, I guess there will be no significant dismantling of what was constructed before. And the hope. I would be happy if people generally get empowered by politics, but at least I guess beyond Sofia, things are not quite happening in this way. And you mentioned coronavirus. Bulgaria is on the first place, I think, internationally in the world, in two rankings which are not positive at all. On one hand, the death rate out of corona crisis is very high in Bulgaria, and on the other hand, the level of vaccination is the lowest in the EU. And I don't want to go much into analysis on that. There are a lot of sensitivities on these issues, and a lot of people who are convinced in their positions on any side of the debate. But basically, maybe I could make also this conclusion in relation also to what you said about Ruse when you were here. There is certain conservatism in people, especially out of Sofia, I guess. So conservatism, not obligatory, or only in the sense of sticking to traditions, dancing popular dances, or, I don't know, going to church. Bulgarians, I think, are less religious than other people in the region. But it is certain conservatism, I guess, in the way of thinking. So people are somehow careful of what they perceive as coming from the outside, at least outside of their circles. And maybe I should say that maybe that is not unique to Bulgarians as well. Basically, I even through my work in Bulgarian-Romanian space, I realized that usually when something new happens, there is certain suspicion that it is organized or orchestrated somehow from the outside. And maybe that explains the certain level of conservatism and the fact that the EU has vaccinated more than 70% of its populations, but Bulgaria and Romania are the two least vaccinated countries against coronavirus right now.
Okay, and it is a little bit surprising what you say, because on one hand, you say that people are conservative and so anxious of change and anxious of trying new solutions, as I may assume. On the other hand, what was taking place in Bulgaria over the last 2 decades was absolutely depressing, and you can say a lot of things about Borisov regime, but not that it assured prosperity, not that it assured a decent standard of living for most Bulgarians. And if we, so I'm wondering if people are conservative and anxious of change, then what must happen in your country so that it finally leaves this vicious circle, handing the power to the same people again and again, making new political projects that are in fact the same people under new logos, and the majority still fighting to survive?
Well, you are asking grand questions, and I have been looking for some answers, at least for me. For me, as I have said also in one program, which I recorded together with my colleagues, among which also in you, for the Paul Jay's podcast, The Analysis, at least in my view, certain internationalization can be hope. Because there are different standards beyond Bulgaria, and if we are answering those international standards, then maybe we can be a little bit more sure that we do also something meaningful in Bulgarian context. I really fear this tendency, which I somehow sometimes compare with quarter thinking, you know, thinking from the quarter of a certain city, that we have certain in-group and we reproduce only what we have in our in-group, and it is kind of mafia approach to society, and I guess that's one reason I'm not so tempted to vote for one, even if it is a good oligarch or a good party against the other. I would be more interested if somebody outline certain vision for changing of deeper social structures. And of course, that is maybe impossible. That is very utopian. Of course, he maybe will be isolated if he's so sincere about what he does. But I guess without certain approach to this problem, no change really takes place. We just reproduce the same thinking which we have been having in transition times or maybe beyond that. And we have just one life. So maybe some people think they're immortal. Maybe they have certain belief in the immortality of certain idea like Bulgarian nation or I don't know what ideology. But in reality, we have certain limited time, and I just hope that our allies, which are now, I guess there is certain attempt to change them, I just hope that the coming allies will be more aware of all those issues. Maybe they will be better educated in the West. Maybe they'll have new ideas. Maybe I'm naive to think it's really something new coming, but in any case, we must always have hope.
It is a very strong message, actually. And I think we could finish at this moment. Just for the end, I will ask you not a grand question anymore. Just I will ask you for a big political prediction. Will Bulgaria have a stable government this year, or well, perhaps in the beginning of the next year? Or how long will this time of instability and election following one another, how long will it last?
I remember that some time ago, maybe even before the first election these years, which were on 4th of April, I gave an interview to the Iranian labor news agency where they asked me what will happen in our region now that Biden is coming to power in the USA. And they also asked me about relations with Russia, etc. But I remember answering something like these contradictions, those mutual accusations, etc., they will continue, I guess, until the right people come to power. At least that's a very Bulgarian way of putting the things, maybe. But I really feel that we shall be summoned to vote as many times as necessary in order to form this stable, possibly pro-Biden majority in parliament or in government. Well, that is the spirit of times. I mean, I would be, there are a lot of claims or, I don't know, attempts to resist change, but that is the spirit of time. And maybe I'm not sure whether the new parliament, which will be formed in after November, will have also this new balance of forces, which will allow for stable majority. But we have two months more. In any case, I'm certain that if it is unable to form a new government, Ruben Radev is in power. Possibly it is expected that he will be re-elected. That will be maybe the biggest intrigue, if he will get re-elections without the votes of the party which has supported the Turkish minority. And well, if in any case, we are no longer no man's land. So whatever happens in the USA, in the Western Europe, it is reflected in our country.
Well, perhaps in the end, the best I can say is to wish you and all the Bulgarians that some prosperity finally comes to your country, and that this never-ending voting finally leads to election of people who want to change something and people who have a vision that you mentioned. And we are going to follow up what is going on in Bulgaria, what is going on in the region. Because our region is, as you said, is very often reflecting things that happen somewhere else, is often influenced by things that happen far away from Eastern and Central Europe. And all these developments indeed influence our everyday lives. So thank you very much for being with us. Don't stay for the second part of the program as well. And don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel Cross Border Talks. Thank you very much.